with us this morning.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars.
Thank you.
Shut
And
Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for today, and I thank you for the opportunity to come here and gather together and worship you, and I pray that you open our hearts and our minds to what Brian has to say. In your name I pray, amen.
Good morning, Parkview. Well, I certainly hope everybody had a good Christmas. I'm sure with the COVID, it might have looked a little bit different this year. I know with us, some felt it was okay to come around others, and some felt it was not. So that was okay. Well, for us, we still had our little Christmas with me and my family, and maybe even a couple extras that my daughters drug in. But I think we even had some pictures on Facebook. One was making the Christmas cookies and the candy with the kids. One was with our Christmas tradition of us having a nice meal and fresh bread that the wife just baked for our communion. You might have even seen me reading from the Bible at the dinner table. And at that time, you could almost see the halos forming around my children. And then another picture was our perfect Christmas morning, all dressed in our matching PJs. And by the way, men, I seen some of the PJs your wives picked out for you. And everyone got exactly what they wanted Christmas morning. And to top it all off, we got the perfect family picture in front of the tree. Sounds perfect, doesn't it? Well, it wasn't. And I believe you guys know it. Nothing turns out perfect. You don't get to see behind the scenes. You don't get to see the mess that was left behind from the cookies. You don't get to see the who did not want to wash the pots and pans from the mess. You didn't get to see the bedhead of the girls as I got up that morning before the family picture. And it reminds me of a song by Matthew West. I know all of you have heard it. It's Truth Be Told. It talks about lie number two. Everybody's life is perfect except yours. And Facebook can make it seem like that. And then he says in there, I'll do this no justice, but he says in there, he says, I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not, I'm broken. And you're welcome, because that'll be stuck in your head the rest of the service. But the point is this, I'm not perfect, you're not perfect. We're all broken sinners, every one of us. But God came down in flesh form to die for our sins and bring us a new covenant. Luke 22:20 says, after supper, he took another cup of wine and said, this cup is a new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. So during this communion time this morning, we need to take time to reflect on our own shortcomings, our own sins, and remember to be thankful for that broken body and the blood that Jesus Christ sacrificed for us. Let's go to prayer. Father, thank you for what you've done for us on that cross. Father, your broken body, the blood you poured out for us. Father, help us to recognize our shortcomings, our sins. Father, help us to do better. Let us remember to strive every day. And Father, remember that you are the reason for this Christmas season. Amen. Well, the first half of the communion, I kind of beat you up and telling you how much of a sinner you are, how much a sinner I am. Let's leave the second half on this on a better note. I want you to remember this one thing the rest of the week. And I stole this from my previous pastor. Remember this, that even on your worst day, you are still a child of the living God. One more time. Even on your worst day, you're still a child of the living God. You pray with me one more time. What seems to be on my heart every week is those in nursing homes. They don't get visitors. They're alone. Some of them die alone. I pray for them. I pray for the loneliness not to hurt as much. I pray that this COVID goes away. Father, you're able to heal us and heal those that are feeling alone. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and Merry Christmas, everybody. I hope everybody's Christmas was great. We are starting a new series in Ecclesiastes, and I was telling Tracy a little bit about what I was going to preach on, and she looks at me and she goes, "That's heavy. You need to lighten this thing up just a little bit." So we discussed things, and I decided to ask a little Facebook question of anybody that's Facebook friends with me, and I said, all right, so the question was, ask your kids what the purpose in life was for. One of the very first responses was this picture right here, and I thought it was kind of ironic that this is actually what I'd already named my sermon, so I figured we can all laugh. Ha, ha, ha. There we are. All right, so we're lighting right now. We're good to go. You're ready to get in. Well, okay, so here were actually some of the responses from some of the kids for what the purpose or your porpoise of life is. A 12-year-old girl answered, getting married and having children. I guess her 10-year-old brother wanted one upper, and he said, to serve God. 15-year-old girl said to live, build things like houses, and to have food. I can relate to that. Matt, who's 10, says to have fun, honest. Johnny, 7, says take care of yourself and your body. Wise kid. Franklin and Pippin Berbrick said green beans. They're dogs. I'm not so sure they said that. Josiah said loving. Hannah said Santa. Chloe said adventure. Madison said happiness. Casey said to live and die. Mabel Matthews said, Nookum goo ga dada ya he, in which her dad said he wishes life would be that simple. And I can relate. Now, a majority of the answers could be summed up with three responses from a lot of the Parkview kids. Evelyn said, to spread God's word. Ava said, to worship God. And Heston said, to pray. Now, we're going to get into the Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes is not this cheery. So if you would, we're going to start, just read all of chapter 1. It's going to be up there if you want to read along in your Bible. That's great as well. But here we go, Ecclesiastes chapter 1. Be prepared to be encouraged. Or maybe not. The words of the teacher, son of David, king of Jerusalem, meaningless. Meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What do people gain from all their labors at which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets. It hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning to its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full to the place the streams come from. Then they return again. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will always be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. There is anything of which one can say, look, there is something new. It was here already, long ago. It was here long before our time. No one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. I, the teacher, was king over Israel of Jerusalem. I applied my mind to studying to explore by wisdom that is done under the heavens. What a heavy burden God has laid on mankind. I have seen all these things, and they are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, a chasing after the wind. What is crooked cannot be straightened. What is lacking cannot be counted. I said to myself, look, I have increased in wisdom and more than anyone who has ruled over Jerusalem before me. I've experienced much of wisdom and knowledge. Then I applied myself to understanding of wisdom and also of madness and folly. But I learned that this too is a chasing after the wind. For with much wisdom comes much sorrow, and the more knowledge comes, the more grief. Now, I have always thought that Ecclesiastes was a really weird book of the Bible. Anybody else? I mean, there's no talk of God in any of it. And I've even questioned, why in the world is this book even in the Bible? Well, here's the thing. The reason this book seems so strange is because there's, in all the other books of the Bible, besides Ecclesiastes, there's a sense that all the other books are preaching at you. Now, by preaching, I don't mean the negative connotation. What I mean is, I'm a preacher, and it is my job to give you answers. The book of Ecclesiastes doesn't give you answers. It just gives you questions. See, if we read the King James Version, it would say, it calls the author of the book the preacher. And if this is the case, this author is an utter and absolute failure. The translation we read, which was teacher, makes a little more sense. The actual Hebrew word is koheleth, and the best translation of this would be the philosophy professor. And so as we go through this chapter, I'm going to refer to the author as the professor. Okay, so when I talk about the professor, I'm talking about the author of Ecclesiastes. And the thing that we really need to understand about Ecclesiastes is that this author of this book, he's more like a seminar leader. His approach to teaching is someone that asks questions. He's a discussion leader. And this book will only be understood if we realize that there are only questions and there's not answers in the book. See, the author's job is not to give you the answers, but he wants to push you and give you questions so that you will actually dig for those answers. I think there's a really great argument that the book of Ecclesiastes should actually be at the very beginning of the Bible. Why? Well, have you ever read a book, maybe a book on philosophy or whatever, where it started with the questions that you needed to ask yourself before you actually started reading that book, questions to prepare you for the book? And as I said, Ecclesiastes is not the place where you're going to find answers. You're going to find answers where? Well, in the rest of the Bible. See, the professor's job is to push us to the logical conclusion of our position. See, the professor wants you to ask the question, why do I believe this or that? And do you see where this leads you? See, Mark and I, during this series, we're going to explore some of the questions that the professor brings up. And some of these questions are the questions that philosophers have been asking for a long, long time. And that's why, and this is why I'm so excited about preaching this book, is because this book is probably one of the most contemporary books of the Bible. See, the professor wants to make us think those questions that we need to ask the Bible so we can understand the beauty and the wonderfulness of the Christian message. So if you would, let's look again at verse 3, because this verse is the verse that kind of it sums up everything that we need to be thinking about. It says, what do people gain from all of their labors for which they toil under the sun? And he kind of answers this at the very end of the chapter, doesn't he? Where he says, the more you experience in life, the more you accomplish, the more you know, what did it bring him? It brought him grief. It brought him sorrow. It made him miserable. See, there's a lot of people out there that they don't feel this way. It's because they're just caught up in the hustle and the bustle and the whirlwind of life, and they never stop and think. And I think that's the key. Because at some point, things are going to stop, and you're going to go, what is life all about? And that's what this question is all about. What gain do you have for all of the work that you've been doing? And this word gain is used in Ecclesiastes 10 times, and it's very unique. Gain, it means leftover, it means profit, and the profit is what is of permanent value that's left over once you've done everything that you need to do in life. Once you've paid all of your bills, once you've started your business, what do you have to show for it? And so the professor asks this question, hey, you are busy with life. You're working really, really hard. But what's the point? What's life for? What are you accomplishing? What difference are you making? Let's suppose you have a friend, and your friend comes up to you and says, hey, you know what? I would really like you to go to the corner of 9th and Market, and I would like you to stand there from 3 to 5 p.m. What would your response be? I'm guessing your response would be the same as mine, which would be, well, why do you want me to do this? And your friend says, whoa, 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 whoa. I asked you to do that. Shouldn't that be enough? I'm your friend. Now, would you say, well, I understand that you're my friend. I understand that your opinion is valuable to me, but I need to know, what's the purpose in me going standing on the corner of 9th and Market at 3 o'clock? See, this is what the professor would say. He would say, see, you will ask a question like that on how you would spend your Tuesday afternoon, but will you ask yourself your question, how are you spending your life? Can you answer? How do you know that your life's not a waste? What are you trying to accomplish with your life? And if you can't ask yourself that question, then you're not living a meaningful and thoughtful life. Actually, I'd say you're living like an animal because you're just living out of instinct. So today, we're going to ask that age-old question, what's the purpose of life? And like a good philosophy professor, he anticipates the answers that most of society is going to give, and then he throws them to the ground. And see, the most common answer, if I were to go out to the streets of Mount Carmel or Evansville or wherever, and I'd say, hey, what's the purpose of life? What are the answers that you would expect to hear? Well, first answer you'd probably expect to hear is, I want to make the world a better place. The second answer you would probably expect to hear is, you know, I just want to have fun. I want to have a good time. I want to enjoy life. But then there are some people that are a little more thoughtful, and their answer would be, you know what, I recognize that this world, it is a miserable place, but I want to be good and noble in the face of that. And see, those are the three questions that the professor anticipates, and those are the questions that we're going to break down today. So let's jump right into this. That very first answer that people give to what's the purpose of life, they say, I just want to make the world a better place. I hear this a lot, but the professor, he'd say, I'm not so sure, because in funerals, we will hear this a lot when we're eating fried chicken and potato salad after the funeral. People will sit around, they'll talk about the person, and they'll say, you know what, they were such a nice person, at least we hope they do, my life has been enriched from knowing them. You know, the world's a little bit of a better place because they were around. They contributed to society. They really helped out. They were a good person. What would the philosophy professor say to that? He would say, guys, that's total nonsense because there's no way that you can make a difference with your life. Aren't you glad you came today? He'd say, you just look at human history. Because in human history, your life is insignificant. He says so in verse 11. He says, no one remembers the former generations, and even those yet will come, and yet even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. All right, no one remembers the generations. Simple question. Who of you can remember your great-great-grandma's maiden name? I know there's one person in this room that can do this, and that's Troy Kemper back there. But anybody else? Do you know your great-great-grandma's maiden name on either side? Anybody? All right, very good. I thought there might be a couple, but for the most part, I can tell you myself, I don't know exactly what my great-great-grandparents did. And those are my people. And I don't remember them very well. If you've watched Les Miserables, there's a scene where there's a bunch of college students and they're sitting on this barricade and they're fighting the oppression and they're fighting for what's right and they're fighting for justice. And one of the guys, he understands the impending doom and he sings these lines. He says, "Will there be anyone to remember me when I fall? Could it be that my life means nothing at all? Is my life just one more life?" And what would the professor's response be to this? Absolutely. No one's going to remember you in 40 years. And the only way that you're going to be remembered in 400 years is if you leave $4 million to your alma mater and they put a plaque on a building. Okay, let's just say, okay, that for some crazy reason, someone in this room becomes the ruler of the world. You might be remembered for 4,000 years, but that's going to be from some archaeologist that digs up your writings and then infers what your life was about. Have I depressed you yet? Here's the thing, though. The professor, he even gets more devastating than that. He says, you know what? You're not going to be remembered in history. Your own family's not going to remember you. But let's talk about science. Let's talk about nature. Does your life mean anything to the history of the universe, to the history and the natural history and the science of this world? And this is what's kind of interesting about the professor, because he takes a very modern scientific approach. He writes in verse 4, he says, "Generations come and generations go, but the earth, the natural world, remains forever." Now, here's the funny thing, because he's writing in a pre-scientific era. Now, let's back up, because I want everybody to be very clear of what I'm trying to get at here. Okay, I'm talking about modern secular scientists and how they approach science, all right? Modern secular scientists. Can everybody agree with me that that's what we're talking about right now? And if you talk with, and especially just the modern mindset anyway, and if you were to talk to someone and talking about the history of the universe, they would say the history of the universe is vast. It's hundreds of billions of years old. And they would also tell you that the sun, our solar system, has not probably been around for all that long. Our star is, the sun is kind of small. And eventually, what's going to happen to the sun? It's going to burn out. And when that sun burns out, what happens to the earth? So if you look at the history of organic life on the earth, in the history of the universe, what does it really matter? It's just like a dot on the timeline, isn't it? And so the professor says the key to understand this is the phrase "under the sun." So what he's telling us is he wants us to assume something. All right, he wants to assume that maybe nature, let's just assume that nature is all there is. You know, this is only life. What you see is what we get. Once again, very modern approach. He wants to say, you know what? A lot of people, when they come into scientific discussions, they don't want to talk about God, right? They want to say, we can't see God. God's a kind of a private thing. God's a very personal thing. We don't really know if there's a God. So scientifically, let's just not talk about God. And the professor says, okay, let's assume that. Let's assume that this is all there is, and let's assume that there is no God, only nature. And the professor says, if that's the case, then nature shows that you are insignificant, because the history of the organic life on this planet, according to modern secular scientists, is just like a flash in the pan. And so what do you have to gain for your life? Nothing. And so imagine someone coming up to the author of Ecclesiastes and saying, hey, do you know what the real problem of the world is today? And he says, what? And they said, well, you know, we're destroying our environment. And if we destroy the environment, then, you know, society is doomed. All life, this world will be uninhabitable. How would the professor respond to that? He would say, are you kidding me? Civilization is doomed regardless because planets come and planets go. So he would say, what you're really asking is, the problem with society is by our stupidity, we might quicken our impending doom by just a little bit. It's a whole lot like we're on a ship and we hit the iceberg and it causes this huge hole in the hull. All right? And the captain comes running up and says, hey guys, the boiler is about to explode. We're going to go down 2 minutes faster. And you would say, oh, let's go fix the boiler right now, right? No, you would say, what's the point? We're going down. Say, who cares? So the question facing us is not, can we stop a nuclear holocaust or can we stop global warming? Because if this is all there is, nothing you do will mean anything, because that sun's going to burn out, right? So if you live a life full of racism, hate, and genocide, or if you live a life of concern, compassion, and love, it's not going to mean anything at all in the end. It's not going to make the world a better place. And so this answer, I want to make the world a better place, it's pointless. So what do we do then? If someone asks, well, what's the meaning of life? What's the purpose in life? I guess then we can have the answer to the next answer, which would be, well, if I recognize what I do is not really going to make the world a better place, then I guess I'm just going to be happy and enjoy my life the way it is. I'm going to be happy and try to find the pleasures in the day in and the day out. Now, a lot of people, they think that this might be the extreme, and I'm not talking about the extremes. I'm not talking about the YOLO moments that we're going to party and we're going to get as crazy as we possibly can. I'm talking about just enjoying the simple things in life. And there are people out there that say, you know what? I just want to be happy. I want to enjoy a sunset. I want to read a good poem. I want to enjoy my family, and I want to find pleasure in my work. I don't want to look at the big picture. I don't want to ask what life means. And the professor won't let us get away with that. See, he says in verse 8, he says, all things are wearisome. More than one can say that the eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear it's full of hearing. And then in verses 12 through 16, what's he do? He says, I had it all. I got to experience all of those things, family and the crazy stuff and the sunsets, everything under the sun he had the means to enjoy. And how did he end up? What's it say? He said it was just a chasing after the wind. C.S. Lewis, he confronts this thought in one of his essays. He says, if this life is all that we have under the sun, and we weren't put here for a purpose, that we're just some accidental collision of molecules. Jack Monod, he was a Nobel Prize-winning French biologist. And he had this outlook. He says, you know why we exist? Our number came up in the card game. We won the crapshoot. He said, the crazy thing about humans is that we were accidentally made by a universe so that we could understand that we were actually accidents. Kind of coined the phrase that we were just grown-up germs. C.S. Lewis responds to this thought. And if he says that we are only grown-up germs, and so we should just find the pleasure in hugging a child or a sunset, here's the problem with that. The only way to do that is that we have to shut off our brains. It's kind of like the ostrich being chased by the wolf. How's the ostrich deal with it? He sticks his head in the sand and says everything's going to be okay. C.S. Lewis says if you fall in love with a girl and you're getting those feelings, but then you really stop and think about it. He says, there's no such thing as love. It's just a feeling of psychic phosphorescence coming out of our genes. He says, if he starts to read a book that he really starts to enjoy, and if this is all there is, And he says, this doesn't really matter because my thoughts are just an electrochemical field of interchanges that are happening in the neurons in my brain. Or if he hugs his child, he recognizes that that child is just an accidental conglomeration of molecules, and my feelings for it are just electrochemical responses in my nerve endings. And so any difference between beauty and ugliness, it's just an illusion. And Lewis finally says this. He says, the only way I can fall in love with a girl or enjoy hugging a child is if I continually stop thinking about reality, if there is no God. Now, guys, this isn't a bad try. So we see that trying to make the world a better place, futile. We have to turn off our brains if we just want to enjoy the world. So what other option are we left? Well, we're left with the option of, you know what, I recognize that this world is a cruel and terrible, senseless place, but I am going to be noble anyway. And my doing the right thing is what it means for me to be human. Well, R.D. Lang, he's a psychiatrist, he recognized this. And he recognized that the world's a cruel and a senseless place. But he says, if you recognize this and you want to be different, then you have to be out of touch with reality. If you're going to live compassionate and a loving life and you recognize life is cruel, then truly compassionate and truly loving people, R.D. Lang would say they are actually insane. Albert Camus, he echoed this, and he said to live an authentic life is to live a life of absurdity. Has anybody, I don't know if you've ever watched this play or read about this play, but Man of La Mancha, anybody know of the Man of La Mancha? Okay, so I thought it might be a little more popular. The only reason I know about it is because in seventh grade, I was told to sing one of its songs. All right, now, the Man of La Mancha, it's about this guy named Don Quixote, and he gets imprisoned, and as he's imprisoned, he sees the futility of life. He sees how senseless is life, but he doesn't want to live this way. He wants to live the lives of knives and knights and chivalry, and that good can actually triumph over evil. And so the whole question in the book is Don Quixote insane or not? Partly because he puts on armor, and he goes with his trusty sidekick, Pancho, and they go attack dragons, and the dragons are actually windmills. And so the big discussion through all the villagers are, is this guy crazy? And one person says, of course he's crazy. There is no chivalry. There are no knights. And right doesn't triumph. Don Quixote is insane. Don Quixote responds, and he says, yes, I am insane, but that is how I find meaning in life. That's how I find meaning in the world. I spit in the face of the cruelty of life. Now, this sounds so noble, but here's the big question. Where do you get the standard of justice and decency? Where do you think that you believe that this world is even cruel? Well, where do you get those answers? Why would you even think the world is cruel? Well, you get those answers in your brain. And what is your brain? It's just a whole bunch of electrochemical reactions that are happening in there. So how can you trust your brain if your brain was just an accident? Where do you get the standard to judge the universe when this is all there is? The professor, he sums it up this way. He says, then I applied myself to understanding of wisdom and also of madness and folly. But I learned that this, too, is a chasing after the wind. Yeah, he says, I tried the madness. I tried being crazy. The bottom line, what the professor is trying to show us is that there is no middle ground. Either there is a God that cares and loves you, he created you, he sustained you, and he is going to judge you someday, or there is nothing under the sun. How can this work if you believe there is no God and you believe that we're just accidents from this world? And what's our future? Annihilation. In other words, if there's nothing under the sun, our past is insignificant. Our future is insignificant. But people say, but while we're here, We need to work for human rights. We need everyone to be valuable, and there needs to be justice for all. And what would the professor say? He would say, come on. And you call Christians naive? Think about the faith that that takes. He says, if my origin is insignificant and my future is insignificant, why in the world would you say my present is significant? At least have the guts to admit that. See, either there is a God and our lives mean something, or nothing at all means anything. So then what does that mean for us? Well, either you are sold out for God and you know Him and He knows you and you're important to Him, or everything is hopeless. And as I said earlier, we don't find answers in Ecclesiastes, so where do we find the answer to this question? Well, we find the answer to this question in John 1:1, one of the greatest verses in the Bible, and it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, a better translation for this word, Word, which is still a good translation, but another translation would be Logos. Okay, the Greek and the Roman philosophers, they were always looking for the logos of life. And what does logos mean? Well, logos means the reason. So they're always looking for the reason of life. And they thought if we could find the logos, then everything would be all right. So let me give you an example of this. Let's pretend that I have you over to my home and I say, hey, would you like to come over and I'd like to pop you some popcorn? And you say, yeah, that popcorn would be great. And I'd say, well, here's the only problem. Sometimes my popcorn comes out soggy, it doesn't really taste right, it sometimes can be a little burnt, and I see from your faces you're saying, how not that's the case. But I have you over and I give you the popcorn and you say, well, I know what your problem is. And I'd say, what's that? You would say, well, you're using your espresso machine to try to pop the popcorn. See, the espresso machine's logos is to make what? Espresso, not popcorn. And the Greek philosophers and the Roman philosophers, that's what they were trying to figure out with the human logos. And they had tried these things that we'd just discussed. They tried other everythings. And they had become so frustrated because they could not find that logos. And then Jesus Christ came. And John said, you're looking for a logos. You're looking for a reason. But it isn't a philosophy brought by a person. The logos is a person. The logos is not an abstract principle. It's not a theorem. It's not something you're going to find in a book. The logos is a human being came down from earth to be with us. And when you serve him, then you find your purpose in life. And because of that, what we do matters. Everything we do matters. And it matters today, and it's going to matter 2 million years from now, because right now counts forever. So I want to go back to that hugging your child example and finding the joy in hugging your child. But you know, sometimes you need to hug your child at times that aren't convenient to you. Let's pretend that that child starts screaming bloody murder at 3 a.m. in the morning. Okay? So you go up to hug that child, and when you hug that child, you smell why that child was screaming bloody murder. So you clean the child up, you get into the muck, you get into the dirt and the grime, and you smell afterwards, and you're tired. And there are two ways that you could look at this interaction. First way you could look at it is that you could see that this baby is just some chance pattern of matter, a chance collision of molecules, and this child, if you really want to stop to think about it, will eventually die and rot, just like you are going to die and rot. And no one will remember them, and nothing that that child does will make any difference at all. And nothing that child will do will come to anything. Or you can recognize that that child is made in the image of God, and this child is an immortal soul, and if he or she becomes a Christian, then 3 billion years from now, you can sit around the throne of God, laughing, loving, talking to one another, and throwing your crowns and giving them to God. See, guys, either everything we do matters now and matters for eternity, or nothing means anything. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Logos? I really don't think there's any other answer. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for giving us the book of Ecclesiastes. I thank you for helping us to dig down into tough questions. And God, I know that you're also a God that doesn't shy away from hard questions. And that we can ask him, that we can have doubts, and you will work through us with those doubts. And so many times that we come out stronger. God, I ask that we be sold out for you, because there's no better way to live, and it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. You guys are free to go.